All right, everybody. This is our MMA Junkie Radio pre-show. We're still crossing some T's, dotting some I's. Today's George's turn to pick the music. So every song that you hear today will be brought to you in part by George.
Maybe like 6 or 8.
All right. I'm going to gather them right now. So how was everybody's weekend?
Really, really good, but really exhausting.
Yeah, me too.
2 minutes.
Victoria, do you care much about March Madness?
No. I just follow it for my bracket.
Oh, you turned in a bracket?
Yeah.
See, I have a file on everybody I know. And in your file right now, I just went in there and added a star. Because chicks that like sports, or at least pretend to, you know, like the big stuff. I'm not saying, hey, who do you think is going to win the cricket match this weekend? But like Super Bowl, you know, are you in a pool? Yeah. Or, you know, do you at least have your favorite baseball team, like a ball cap somewhere in the closet, so that if someone says, you want to go to the game, boom, you're in. You don't look like a Momo standing out.
Yeah, definitely.
Exactly. That's all. You know, that's all people ask.
Where I'd rather be.
Mm-hmm. All right.
So. I'm big into sports here.
Who are your teams?
I'm a Mets fan, baseball. I'm a Jet fan, football. I like the Knicks, Rangers, hockey.
Sounds like our buddy Sam All Jam.
Yeah.
Those are his squads.
I was rooting for Duke and the tournament.
Oof.
That's over. Yeah.
That was a hard hit for a lot of people.
I was also rooting for Northwestern.
Because of Julia Louise Dreyfus?
Yes. Yes.
It was pretty cool to see her in there.
In the stands.
And that little kid, you see the little kid that would cry and cheer? And wow.
Yeah.
I thought maybe he was the coach's son or something, but he's just a fan.
Yeah, that was crazy. There's like a million memes about him today.
Was there?
Or yesterday. Yeah, I think so.
He's going to be the new crying Jordan meme?
I don't know if he'll take over of that, but... All right, guys, here we go.
All right, let's do this.
This is your captain speaking. We are making our descent into Las Vegas McCarran Airport. On behalf of our crew, we'd like to thank you for flying MMA Junkie Airlines. Now please fasten your seatbelts and put your tray tables in your upright position because the descent is going to be a little bit bumpy.
Alright, Junkie Nation, it's time to roll, baby, on MMA Junkie Radio with Gorgeous George and Go. This is what we do and why we do it, baby. All night long, we rollin'! Yes!
The MMA Junkie Radio revolution is upon us.
Can you dig it?
There's no escape.
No escape.
Through the vast frontier of cyberspace, and through a sea of stars in outer space.
One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
We've solidified our combat communication stranglehold.
We are controlling transmission.
With the use of MMA Junkie Radio and Sirius XM satellite radio technology.
MMA Junkie Radio, commence transmission.
Live from MMA Junkie Radio HQ in the fight capital of the world, Las Vegas, Nevada. Here are your hosts, Gorgeous George and Go.
It's Monday, March 20th, live from the Race and Sportsbook here at the Mandalay Bay Resort and Casino, where elegance and excitement meet on the Las Vegas Strip. It's the MMA Junkie Radio Show. I'm your host, Gorgeous George. To my left is the devious and dastardly Goes, Ari's co-host, and back east, she'll be doing all the producing duties for today. It's Victoria. What's up?
What up? How you doing?
What's going on?
Not much.
I'm dying, man.
March Madness killed you, huh?
March Madness killed me.
10-9, 10-9, 10-9, 10-9, or did you get the best of it on some days?
Oh, no, no. I got the best of it on a lot of days.
All right.
Just a combination of not really sleeping and drinking. But now I can't tell if I'm just so tired that I feel like I'm getting sick,
mm-hmm.
or if I am getting sick, and I don't like that. So I have... you know, resting bitch face?
Yeah.
I have resting sneeze face. I'm ready to sneeze at any moment, I think.
Uh-oh.
So I'm hoping I'm not getting sick. But I did say that the other day I told you I haven't been sick in a really long time. Mm-hmm. And I'm at the point now where if I did, I would just welcome it because I had a good run.
Gotcha. Is your how's your bracket doing?
I didn't do a bracket.
I wasn't talking to you. You're soft because you didn't turn one in. I was talking to Victoria. How's it going? Other than Duke, like, are you doing all right? Or?
No, I'm not doing that great.
No?
I think I'm in 60th.
What? Oh, wow. That's a nice – that's a great pool of people. So how many people are in your pool?
There's a lot more than – I think there might be like 70, 75.
Damn. Sammy the Squid could only rally 31. 25 a pop, so it's like a $500, $600 pool. I'm in 24th, 26th place, but what I do have is max points available. I'm one of the leaders. So I think even though I struggled with the first couple rounds, I have a shot at the end because my final four is alive, and that's always a good thing.
Shit, your pool's soft. 31 people?
That's it.
Back in the day when I used to run it, it was like in the 60s.
Was it?
Yeah.
Wow.
I was running brackets when y'all's was nothing.
I tried it. I tried to give him a hand. You know, I did a Facebook post, which goes to Twitter. And then I blasted an email like three times. Like, I did the, sorry I'm late, but this starts in about a day and a half. And then, hey, we're down to about 12 hours. And then one last one with about an hour left. And some of the people that I heard had joined, I was taking them off the email just not to be a pain in the ass. So somehow I got up to 31, which is cool. But, yeah, I'd like to get in one where it's like 100 or something.
Yeah, that's fun. But, you know, I'm starting not to like them anymore because it's hard to sit here and have money on the games, betting the games.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, you have certain things that you need in your bracket. I don't know. It just doesn't make sense.
Well, sometimes. Treat it differently. The way I did goes is I made my picks and then kind of just left it because there's really nothing I can do. There's no hedging or you can't make alterations to it in round two. So then I focused on whatever was happening here, a first of 15, a parlay, you know, this, that, whatever, my own gut feelings. And then I just kind of come in and go, oh, yeah, that's where I'm at. So it's I just treat it like two different things. Same thing with fantasy football and gambling on football. Just because I have, you know, this quarterback, it doesn't mean all my eggs are out in one basket. Because it's a great thing when it all comes together. You win your fantasy league. You win your, you know, you did good on the gambling side. But you can also take a hard crash, too. So this just kind of gives you different forms of entertainment. But that's all I've been doing is just logging in at the end of the day, seeing how I'm doing. And as you can tell, I'm not doing too well. But I do have the promise of, as the tournament continues, at least some teams are alive. And you know what? It's because I don't like to go chalk, even though most of the best teams advance. Early on, I like to take some chances in the first couple rounds, and maybe that's a detriment because I find myself behind others that didn't do that, and now it's almost impossible to catch them. But there's some people that really just – it chaps my hide when someone turns in four number ones or even three number ones kind of gets on my nerves. It's like, have some fun, man. Like, literally, all number ones, what's the fun in that?
I guess.
Other than if you win it, then I guess it's fun cashing that check. Or
there is some years where, I think it was last year, where it really did make sense.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, even when it does make sense like that, I still know that that's just not going to happen. So you got to find that two or that three that's going to do something.
It's like buying Madden 18 this year and going, I got the Patriots. You know, it's like, pick your team. Why do you have the Patriots? You're a Saints fan. You know, go with them. Have a little bit of fun. Yeah, I don't know. Whatever. This past weekend, we had a couple MMA events. We'll talk about the madness, too. If you want to share how your bracket's doing, call in 866-522-2846. This past weekend, there was a lot of combat sports. In boxing, we had Triple G and Chocolatito on the same card. That was cool. In MMA, there was WSOF 35 at the Turning Stone Point Casino in Verona, New York. Three titles. In their offering, and then UFC Fight Night 107, which took place earlier that day in London. So we'll start off with the one that a lot of people like to talk about, the UFC. It's the IT promotion in our sport. Jimmy Manua defeated Corey Anderson via a KO punch in round one. Place went nuts. He's a Londoner, and there was 15,000 there. They've come strong the last 2 years. That's going to become a yearly stop for the UFC.
Yeah. You know, one thing I realized this weekend, George, was the step that I believe MMA has taken over boxing. Because with March Madness going on, I didn't miss a goddamn thing. I still woke up early for Manchester United. the Canelo fight, I was still able to watch it. But here's what happened.
Canelo? Triple G.
Triple G. We were at the studio, so we wanted to continue to watch basketball games and then find a place to go watch the boxing. We could not find a place in all of Vegas that was showing that fight. Boxing. Uh-huh. This is one of the best fighters in the world, and we couldn't find any place that was
Triple
showing,
G and Chocolatito.
Yeah, that was showing this pay-per-view. However, MMA, all the time. And we came across a few venues that said we have contracts where we can only show MMA. Mm-hmm. So I think MMA took a big step forward. This is the fight capital of the world. How could you not find a place that's showing a boxing pay-per-view of that caliber?
Right. You know, I couldn't tell you what the deal is in terms of traction, you know, between both sports. I feel like they're both there. I think I hear a lot of chatter from my boxing peeps about the about that fight card, and then my MMA peeps about the two that happened on Saturday night. Mm-hmm. But one thing for sure, I hate to pick on this sport because I want to learn even more about it, and I try and learn even more about it. But it'll revolve around our guest today. King Mo Lawal will join us at 2:30 p.m. Eastern time, 11:30 a.m. Pacific time. We'll talk about his fight versus Quentin Rampage Jackson coming up here in about 10 or 11 days, 31st to be exact, at Bellator. March Madness. You know, there was like a small screen that would pop up here at the sportsbook, and then when I was changing the channels, I'd come across it. But why do they insist on going up against March Madness and then the boxing that's going on? It just doesn't seem like a wise decision.
I don't know.
And it seems like they have their niche, you know, of that's their weekend, but why do it on that weekend?
It seems foolish to me. I thought it was kind of cool that we actually did have it on a few TVs at certain times. We'd have it on three TVs mm-hmm. here at Mandalay Bay. So that it says a lot for that, you know, niche to start growing like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
But the fights, the MMA, I mean, I thought it was a great card. I thought it was fun.
And that's you saying that despite the fact that there was a big run of decisions.
Yeah.
It was a lot of decisions, but there was a lot of action in those decisions. So Lena Landsberg versus Lucy Pudlova, unanimous decision, but a lot of people really enjoyed that fight.
That eye. I haven't seen an eye blow up like that. It's so crazy. If that happens in a car accident, people go, oh, my God, your eye, is it okay? Will you ever be able to use it again? So the fact that she could take that type of punishment to an eye and then know that in the next fight that could happen again.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man, that's just kind of the warrior spirit inside of her.
For sure. Brad Scott defeated Scott Askham. If you don't believe him, ask him. It was a split decision win for Brad Scott. Mark Diakise defeated Timo Pakkalen. What a punch.
Wow.
Yeah. He put on a show for 30 seconds that he was in there, man. He had some fancy kicks and then a punch, and that was it. Good for him. American Top Team product. Has two losses. Couldn't believe that. I thought, is this an undefeated fighter? What's his deal? Leon Edwards defeated Vicente Luque. Luque just ran out of steam, man. Unanimous decision there. Timothy Johnson defeated Daniel Omelinchuk. Split decision there. I thought it should have been unanimous, but someone called around for Omelinchuk. And things were tight, but usually heavyweights just don't go that far into their fights. We usually get some sort of a finish. So they were probably caught off guard themselves, you know.
I think so, yeah.
A couple of them probably ran out for a donut or a coffee or something, and they had to be rushed back. No, they're still going. Francimar Barroso defeated Darren Stewart, unanimous decision. Joe Duffy defeated Reza Madadi, unanimous decision. But that was kind of an interesting show between those two, mm-hmm. Madadi and Duffy. So, again, at that point in time, of the seven fights that were there, six of them had finished via decision, only one via KO, but I didn't see any people clowning on it. There was some good action, and I think the crowd also brought it.
Yeah, great action in all the fights. I thought it was a great card overall. I'm going to give it an 8.
If anybody's wondering why I haven't mentioned Tom Breese at any point, his fight versus Oluwole Bamgose was canceled, I guess. Moments before the event was to start, Breeze was deemed unfit. And also, the day before, I believe, now you're testing my memory, Ian Entwistle, his fight also versus Brett Johns, did not go down. Entwistle was pulled from the card. It was the day before the event. The bout was canceled. So that was two that just went out the window. Now we get to the main card. Arnold Allen defeated Makwani Amirakani via split decision.
Tough fight. That could have gone fight. Either way. Every single round was just up for debate. It was a great fight. But I thought they made the right choice.
So did
I. Don't know about 30-27, though.
That Amirakani was just going after that neck. Mm-hmm. I mean, repeatedly. And Arnold Allen had to fight through some tough moments. But he came out ahead and thought he had an interesting post-fight speech. He said, look, I'm not good at talking trash. What do I do? What can I do? How can I get to your status? Dan Hardy, the color commentator, who was also doing the post-fight interviews. And, Dan, I think, helped him through that. And I expect to see more things from Arnold Allen. Allen's a guy that we've covered through Cage Wars, so we're very familiar with him. Marlon Vera defeated Brad Pickett. Oof, this one's a tough one. Because everybody knew this was Pickett's last fight. And the WEC and UFC veteran has been in the sport for a while, has a lot of respect. He's part of a big team, American Top Team. And he's one of the more famous UK products ever in our sport. So a lot of people had well wishes for him prior to, during the event, and post-fight. And this is a fight that was basically his with just over a minute left. He got caught by a head kick and then some punches, some follow-up punches. And the referee pulled off Marlon Vera, who defeated Brad Pickett. Brad Pickett was up 20-18 on all the judges' scorecards. So he was literally coming around the third or fourth turn, ready to just take the checkered flag, sail off into the sunset, grab that win bonus. I'm not sure about any other type of bonus, but at least he would have grabbed that bonus. And it just would have been a great night for Brad Pickett. People were on their feet, cheering him on. Vera was a great dance partner for him. A lot of respect between both guys, but Vera had a job to do, and he did it.
Brad Pickett wanted to go out with a KO. Mm-hmm. Because you're right, he had that fight locked down. And I wouldn't even.
And he was locking down rounds by using the takedown and controlling him from top.
Well, I was going to say, I don't even think he needed to really play it safe, because whatever he was doing in round one and two was actually working. I mean, he took a few chances here and there. I didn't think he had to grind him out or anything like that. He just had to kind of do what he was doing, but he put his foot on the gas and it caught up to him. And it sucks, you know, because you don't want to see him to go out that way, especially when he was ahead in the scorecards. But I mean, I think that's just a testament to who Brad Pickett is.
Your thoughts on the stoppage?
Justified. Very much so. I think a lot of people felt it was a little short, mm-hmm. only because they knew this was Brad Pickett's last fight.
Throw me in that group. I don't know if it was because I thought it was his last fight or because of the reaction to Pickett. Now, granted, the referee doesn't know the reaction until after he stops the fight. But the way Pickett got up from that onslaught, it didn't look like a fighter that's, you know, who's finished when they're laying and they're sprawled out. And obviously the first thing you want is medical attention. He looked like a fighter that was ready to go. The referee doesn't know this as it's going. And all he can do is use the information he has that's stored, meaning the head kick, the follow-up punches, and then come to a decision. I always say I'm one of the guys that sides with giving them as much time as possible, maybe even slightly over what most people concern late. Not anything too egregious, but I just feel like these fighters, man, they go through a lot, and the win and the loss, it really does matter. In this case, it was just a win bonus and a way to end a career. I mean, it's still a good career, but it would have been a great ending to a good career.
But when he stood and up, his leg buckled. I mean, like, he stood up, mm-hmm. but it's like he was like.
I'm okay with legs buckling. Legs buckle in fights.
He was bad.
I don't have a problem with the stoppage, by the way. I just wish it could have went longer, and I think it could have gone longer. And the only thing I think is it's hard to describe. The best way I was describing it was just another sequence. And I don't know if another sequence meant another punch or an elbow or I guess just another split second is what I was looking for. And during that time, it could be that he connects with the punch. It could be that he misses with a punch. Maybe Pickett grabs a single. I don't know. Maybe there's just that little lifeline for the fight to continue. Yes, I bet you there's part of me that thought, well, it is his last fight. But I've really, really started to just, after talking to more and more fighters, they want as long as possible. In fact, Pickett said it himself, man. He goes, I wish they would have just scraped me off, you know? That's the way I go down. And a lot of people will say, well, what about fighter safety? And I'm for it, but realize that this is just a violent game. This is the way it's going to go down. I think a lot of fighters, that's their preference. And so that's why I side with them. Anyway, Vera wins. Good for him. This was a catchweight bout, but he still scores a lot of points because he took the fight like on a week notice. Pickett will now retire and focusing, I think, on he's got a promotion and he wants to be a better family member, you know, to his kids, significant others, a teammate and a coach. So we wish you the best, Brad Pickett. Gunnar Nelson defeated Alan Jouban. Goes. He looks slick. He looked pretty good.
I don't know what was going on with Alan Jouban. You know, early on in round one, he was throwing the kick, but you could tell Gunnar was waiting for it to catch it. I don't know. I don't want to say the guy didn't put a big enough effort, but it just didn't seem like the Alan Jouban that we've seen in previous fights.
He was very tentative because he knew he can't get a kick caught, mm-hmm. or he couldn't leave an opening for Gunnar because that would get that could get the fight to the ground, and that would potentially be, you know, doomsday. So he just looked like a tentative striker. And the other guy looked really relaxed. And now his striking has not caught up to Joban's. Or maybe you could say caught up. He won the fight via strikes that led to a submission. But he definitely made some grounds on a lot of the welterweights out there who just think he's a submission artist.
I mean, that's just crazy that Gunnar Nelson's skill set is to the point where he can manipulate the opponent into not doing things, you know? He almost looked like Alan Jouban looked like his prey, mm-hmm. if that makes any sense. And I thought it was a great performance from Gunnar Nelson. I like the who they're talking about matching him up with Wonder Boy for the next fight. So
Karate versus Karate.
I think that'd be fun, man.
I miss Rick saying that. Rick from New York.
Oh, yeah.
Karate versus Karate. And Jouban, who I thought was, you know, early on I wasn't too sure about his skills, and he kept getting better and better. This is a tough fall for him. This is a tough, tough loss because now he kind of gets grouped with guys that are anywhere between 15 and 25. He was looking for top 10, and this was his chance to maybe leap into the UFC top 10, the USA Today Sports and MMA Junkie top 15. It just didn't go his way, and it wasn't even one of those where you look good in a losing effort like 1 week before what happened with Darius, who looked great before getting caught. So Gunnar Nelson, congrats to you. And then, of course, back to Manoa, who defeated Corey Anderson. Boy, I don't know what to say. I mean, these the wrestlers that – there's the wrestlers who are, I guess, in for my taste, more focused on the strikes to set up the wrestling than vice versa.
Yeah.
It's – I don't know. I mean, even if it's just the stance for crying out loud, I mean, let us know that there's a wrestler in you first rather than you just, I guess, trying to play the part of a kickboxer. I don't know. Anderson had said that he was going to get away and get back to his roots. He's a country boy who can wrestle. And maybe that was the plan, but I just think it needs to start a lot sooner. It is a fight. I mean, 2 minutes is a lot of fighting time. On the streets, a two-minute fight? Come on, that never exists. Usually these things are over like in 20 seconds because guess what? A lot of the times either you're getting slammed to the ground or you're getting caught in the jaw and that's it. Well, guess what? I know this is a sport. It's different, but there are some parallels. And I'm sorry, man, but you got to be threatening with what you do best. And it looked like he was still standing and waiting for that opportunity. And 2 minutes is a long time with a heavy hitter like Jimmy Manoa.
You want to make Manoa uncomfortable. And he looked very comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
That's the problem. You know, just the shot he hit him with was incredible. I can't remember who said it, but somebody said it looked like he got electrocuted. That's how the shot just hit him cleanly and he just dropped. I mean, great performance. And then I like what he did afterwards, calling out everybody at the top. He wants the belt. This is a
but he doesn't want to fight John Jones.
He doesn't want to fight John Jones. And
but he has to figure out that that's either going to happen now or at some point. Right?
I mean, I don't really understand the reason. It's just you're going to have to face him. You know, if you're going to be one of the best fighters in the world, at some point you'll probably have to fight him.
Mm-hmm. The attendance, to be exact, was 15,761. Total gate was 2015, 777. So again, the O2 Arena packed. London came strong. Congrats. And I think when you do this, guess what, man? They're going to want to come back because that's a solid gate. And it's also a solid attendance figures. And this being a card that wasn't as sexy as last year's card, not by much, but Anderson Bisping is pretty special. I think next time they're going to get themselves a solid, I mean solid, card.
I really hope so. I really do. Because, you know, up until we got Alan Joban and Gunnar Nelson, like, that wasn't early on. That was, what, like 5 weeks out or something like that?
Mm-hmm.
That fight was announced. I would imagine the people that paid for those tickets were not rolling their eyes, but a little nervous because the card just didn't hold up to the last time they were there. But you're right. As long as you guys show up. I mean, they were there from the get-go, from the first fight, that place was packed. And I don't see them. This has got to be a yearly stop. And I think they should be rewarded with the next card.
You know, earlier I mentioned, I said the word bonus. You know, Pickett could have possibly gotten a bonus if he had finished, or maybe if him and Vera stepped it up in that last round, a fight of the night bonus. But there was no fight of the night bonus at all. The performance bonuses of the night were Jimmy Manua, Gunnar Nelson, Marlon Vera, Mark Diakisi. Hopefully I'm pronouncing the last gentleman's name right, but Mark Diakisi, the guy that knocked out Teemu Pakkalin, he was the one that got the last 50K bonus. So congrats to all of them, and congrats to UFC. Solid work. All right, we're going to take this break. When we come back, we'll take some calls, and then we'll also go over the World Series of Fighting 35 edition that took place on Saturday night, this past Saturday night, that had three titles up for grabs. One that was a vacant title that was won by Bekbulat Magomedov. Andre Harrison also defended, unseeded Lance Palmer for their featherweight title, and then Blagoy Ivanov defended his. So we'll talk about that, and we'll take some calls. When we get back, you're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on Sirius XM Rush 93. Hi. Nice to meet you too. Congratulations. We're just looking at that. Very cool. Congrats. Huh?
You know that scene in Star Wars where Darth Vader tells Luke he's his father? What if I walked in right after with my voice and was like, I'm your Uncle Walter. Can I get a lift home? That'd be crazy, right? Anyway, here Georgian goes.
You gotta let this song drop.
Yeah, it would be disrespectful if we didn't do that.
Yeah. This is Money for Nothing by Dire Straits.
Do you think Victoria knows this song?
Yeah,
I agree with the boys.
She didn't balk at any of them. If I would have told Danny the same lineup that I told Victoria, he would have said, what? Ooh, what? Mm-hmm. So I think she's hip to the 80s a little bit.
This was one of the cool music videos, too.
It was. And that, by the way, is Sting with Dire Straits. Did you know that?
No.
With the background vocals?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's him. This is back when MTV showed videos on MTV.
This is one of the ones that started it.
Now it's reality TV. I love it. All right. We're going to take calls at 866-522-2846. We'll talk about UFC Fight Night 107 and World Series of Fighting 35. Today's music's brought to you by me. So if you dig it,
what's your slogan?
Give me a follow at MMA Junkie George on Instagram or Twitter. My slogan is, if you don't like what I like, that's too bad.
All right.
You put me on the spot. I didn't really have a slogan.
Well, I thought you were going to be like, you know, who can ask for anything more?
Oh, yeah. I didn't know. Anyway, is there anything you wanted to add to UFC Fight Night 107? I mean, we talked about every matchup, but any notes that came out of that? You know, a couple fights fell out. That sucks. Some of them, I bet you, have to do with the body reacting to a bad weight cut, which, by the way, why is that the case so much now? Whereas before, it wasn't.
It easier on them, right?
That's what I thought.
The only thing I can think of coming out of the card that I was thinking about a little bit was you're losing Brad Pickett, right? I'm not so sure that we're replacing these athletes, these European athletes, as well as we should be. I don't know if there's that nice cream of new fighters coming out. And I'm wondering what's going on because they had a little bit of a boom not too long ago.
Well, I was going to say the opposite. You haven't seen more Europeans fighting?
Maybe I'm just talking about the UK then, I guess.
Okay. Well, Arnold Allen, that was nice. Yeah. You know what I mean? That was nice. That was nice. I guess because we were so used to seeing a lot of names through Cage Warriors, maybe we thought it would be more. But
it could be.
Let me see. It was Leon Edwards, right? Is he from the UK?
Mm-hmm.
I thought he was beatable, by the way, the other night. So Luque, he just gassed is what it came down to. That last round is what it came down to. But anyway, let's take these calls. They've been waiting for a while, and then I want to touch on WSOF 35. One of the titles switched hands, and I knew it would come down to round five, man. God damn, so close. The party almost hung on to his title, but congrats to Audrey Harrison. Still undefeated, and two major belts on his mantle, the Titan FC featherweight belt, and now the WSOF featherweight belt. If you haven't fought in Bellator or the UFC, those are some nice titles to be having on your resume. Marco from Waco, what's going on, man?
Marco from Waco, door. I want my MTV. Damn, that's a long time since I haven't seen a music video on MTV or VH1, dude. That's a long time.
Did you have
a
favorite video?
No, from back in the day, man. I was always into the Michael Jackson videos because they were freaking works of art, you know, like the Thriller video, of course, and I'm Bad. And all that stuff, but you know, back in the day, you know, it was you know what I'm saying. They were like works of art. They put a lot of production on those videos.
Yeah, so. I liked Aha's. I thought Aha's really stood out. The cartoon. Mm-hmm. You know how they become real?
That's top 10.
Become part of the cartoon?
That's got to be top 10.
Yeah. What about George Michael? He did some cool videos, too. Oh, well. Hey, I don't know, but Jimmy Manuel, nice win, man. Wouldn't it be nice to have a Ryan Bader right now to match him up with? Because I don't think he's getting a Rambo Johnson or Gustafsson once they beat him, too. You know, he trains with the guy. And unless DC wins, and DC is going to get John Jones on the way back. He's just stuck within a rock and a hard place, man. I feel for Jimmy Manuel right now. Good knockout, though. Can't complain about that. And then Joe Duffy, he's negotiating his contract. It will be a travesty if they let him go, because if they need to go to Ireland, they don't have Conor McGregor anymore. Conor McGregor fights in Vegas. So you need to get Joe Duffy to fill that car. And they left the European director of the UFC resign. And I don't know what they're doing out there, man. We'll let you guys catch us tomorrow.
Okay, we'll see you, Marco. And how about if the UFC isn't going to do anything public with the new owners? How about just some kind of an address, you know? Like,
what do you mean?
A conference call. Like, if they're not going to do a direct interview with any outlets, how about maybe like some sort of a conference call where, you know, you get us for 30 minutes, but like Marco says, there is some confusing things that are happening within the UFC, and let's just use one of them. Ryan Bader, it looks like he's probably headed to Bellator. I don't think that anything's official, but that's what I'm hearing. Why would you want to lose another 205er? Just how does that – explain to us how that makes sense. If Ryan Bader comes in and goes, I want $400,000 a fight, and you only want to give him $200,000, guess what? This may be the one time that you can go, sorry, the bean counters or whatever, and say, we don't have any more 205ers. He's got us by the balls. We're just going to have to pay him. Now, going forward, let's stock up these shelves. And let's get a scouting department. Let's get some more 205ers out there. But they almost lost, or they did lose Krylov. They almost lost Sirkinov, and they're probably going to lose Bader. And a year ago, they lost Davis. Well, I'm talking about just 205. Oh, yeah. You see, now Larkin's a different story. Larkin's where when like if Larkin comes in and goes 400K, then maybe they can go 200K, and then he goes no 400K, and they go no it's 200K. And guess what? If you piss us off, now it's going to be 175K because we have about 90 solid welterweights. And at least 20 or 25 like you. He's in a stacked division. Mm-hmm. See what I'm saying? 205 is not a stack. So the negotiations have to go a little bit different.
I think they're making a statement. I think they're just saying, look, I know you guys are all chasing the Ronda Rousey, Conor McGregor money, mm-hmm. but we're making these exceptions because these are the guys that are selling pay-per-views.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's starting to catch up with them
but
a little bit.
But at the risk that a division could crumble, Jones isn't anything faux show. DC said, hey, these are my next three fights, and he may sail off into the sunset. Two of them involve John Jones. And then the last one is AJ, who surprised us and said, look, I don't want to fight forever either.
Well, I like your idea of them coming out and addressing things, because the one thing about the old regime, Zuffa, was no matter what, you always felt like, but they must have a plan.
Mm-hmm.
They're seeing something else. And they would prove that over time. I don't know if these guys have a plan or what their deal is. I just think they picked a stance and they're sticking to it.
If the plan is to just make as much money as possible to recover, which it sounds like it, then you know what? Why don't you tap Joe Rogan on the shoulder and go, how about you and CM Punk? I bet you that would draw a lot of eyeballs.
I like the idea from the other day about Dan Bilzerian and CM Punk.
Dan Bilzerian versus CM Punk. At this point, get the celebs involved. You know, more super fights, just agree on catch weights, and let's just do Pride for a few years, you know, until some loan payments are paid off or the debt's brought down, and then we'll start calling it a sport. But we'll say it's more entertainment than sport for now, because guess what? We overpaid. Mm-hmm. I think you tell me that, you know what I'd go? Salud. Where do I start? What do you want me to promote? Rogan or Bilzerian? Where do I start? At least I know something now.
Yeah.
But the fact that I think it's a sport and they're proving me wrong or confusing me a little bit, I don't know. Don't you want to hang on to the best 205ers in the world? You know, that was the marquee division for years. Ortiz, Nadal, Couture, Jackson came over. Remember, Quinton?
That's us. That's the hardcores, right? Like, think about boxing this weekend, right? You don't really keep up with boxing.
I became a hardcore,
much, right?
But first I was a casual. So we need more casuals to become hardcores.
Okay, but we just bought a pay-per-view.
Yeah.
Because Chocolatito's fighting. We didn't know who he was fighting. We didn't care what rank he had, mm-hmm. if he was next or somebody else got passed over. Same thing with Triple G. We didn't care. We just wanted to see those two guys fight, right? Mm-hmm. We bought the pay-per-view. I think there's a lot of people that just do that. Who's the guy at the top? What is this main event? Okay, cool. I want to see that guy. I'm not so sure that they get wrapped up in who's next, that sort of thing. I think there's a good chunk of people that do, but I think a lot of people just say, who am I watching tonight?
I don't know. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you're right. I didn't know much about Daniel Jacobs. I didn't know much about the – who was it? It was a Thai fighter, right?
All you needed was
– Did we find out his background? Was he Thai?
Yeah, he's Thai.
Okay.
All you needed to hear was, you know, the guy's record and that he's good, right? Mm-hmm. He can present a challenge for Triple G. That's all you needed to hear. It was enough to sell you.
Yeah. All right. Let's go to Hal in Chicago. What's up, Hal?
Hey, guys. For the second week in a row, I need to stun gun this Little League commissioner. You know, I try to come at him, like you said, George, you know, respectful, just said, hey, listen, man, this is kind of a silly idea. Can we get a decent, you know, regular name for the team? And
yeah, what are you guys again? The Butchers?
We were the plumbing and hardware?
Plumbing.
Noble's Kitchen and Baths.
Let me write this down so I can laugh my ass off. Noble's Kitchen and Baths. That's your actual team name.
Yeah. And long story short, we went back and forth. I even said, why don't you give me a call, man, so we can talk about this like men. And, of course, you know, people nowadays, they want to just have email wars. So it got into this thing and, you know, try to make it look like I was trying to be a troublemaker, you know.
Does your hat say NKB on it or?
Nothing. It just says that. Finally, we, you know, at the end, I think they probably just wanted to shut me up. I just said, look, I just want to be the Knights. So, you know, we're the Knights. So we're, you know, at least we're the Knights now.
Oh, K-N-I-G-H-T? Because knowing those guys, yeah, they might have gone with just Knight. N-I-G-H-T.
I'm sure they want to tell me good night. But anyway, stung on that fool.
The Knights. All right, that works.
Noble's and
what do we play this weekend? The Diamond Heads or what's it called? Diamondbacks? The Dodgers? The Giants? No, we got Noble's Kitchen and Bath this week. Oh, okay.
Right. Or Noble's Knights at least.
Hey, did you throw out that line at all where you said, what are we supposed to do after the game? Or what are other teams supposed to do after the game, say, 2, 4, 6, 8. Who do we appreciate? Noble's Kitchen and Bath. Noble's Kitchen and Bath. Noble's Kitchen and Bath. Yay! If you would have said that, I guarantee you would have went, oh, my God, we are fucking dumb. Let's go with the Knights.
Oh, man. I mean, I don't know why it's not dumb. It's pretty obvious. But his response was, why don't you focus on running quality practices?
Shit.
Yeah, he got like that. Yeah, so I got a little nasty back, and then I was like, you know what, this ain't worth it. So I just kind of, like, was the bigger man. I let it go, and then, like, a day later, they responded. They're like, all right, you guys are the Knights. So, big dummy. Oh, that was unnecessary. Anyway, I also want to stun gun WME, man. They let Michael McDonald go. See, the problem is that they just sold out the O2 Arena in England with a payroll of less than $100,000. And they had a great night. Jimmy Manuel rocked the house. You know what I mean? They had all these great personalities. Amir Khani.
Uh-huh.
And that's the problem, man. But I think these guys walked in, and they were like, whoa, you guys were paying what for what? You guys did what? And it's like, yeah, man, that's how we kind of got big. You invest in your own company, and it's expensive. And it just seems like they're looking at WWE and saying, nobody knows who's going to fight tomorrow on SmackDown, but it's going to be sold out, and that's who we want to be. You know, it's the UFC with coming to town. Don't worry about who's fighting. It's the UFC. But they're letting way too many good fighters go, man. I don't like it.
That's right. McDonald asked for his release and got it. He's young, too. He's young. He took two years off, and he's still young, by the way. Talented fighter, but, you know, he wanted out, and he's out. Now, here's the thing. I'm just wondering, it's great that Bellator's scooping some of these guys up, but how many are they going to be able to scoop up?
And at what
cost?
What,
yeah, exactly. Like, what kind of backing do they have, and how does it register on their end? They don't sell pay-per-views. They try and get ratings. You know what I mean? It's kind of a whole different ballgame. Mm-hmm. And I guess maybe one day it'd be nice to talk to Scott Coker. He's a little bit of a vault at times. But maybe some sort of an explanation. Like, what does this translate into? Because, like, a Las Vegas TV exec once explained to me, hey, just pop in Cops. The replay gets 2 million viewers, you know, and there's no overhead there. Whereas over here, you got to pay some fighters, you got to pay production, you know, you got to pay the staff that supports. So, actually, I was having a conversation with somebody in the know that gave me a little bit of an education on that. But, I mean, I don't know that Bellator will be able to scoop up just anybody either.
Well, it depends at what price, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, now don't they have a little bit of bargaining power now with Michael McDonald? Because he doesn't have the option of signing with the UFC. Mm-hmm. So his options are Bellator, World Series, one championship. I think you kind of leave it there. I'm not so sure he can get a ridiculous price like that.
I told Goz the other day, Harold. I'm not wrong. Harold, whatever. I told him the other day that I wish either one would buy WSOF, WSOF would buy one would buy Bellator would buy any combo of those three. A nice shakeup like that would be interesting.
Yeah. Did you guys talk about Chito Vera? Marlon Vera?
Yeah. I'm sorry. I was like, Guinness is away. Marlon Vera. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Against Brad Pickett. Solid performance. Late notice. So you know, emotion. He took the fight at 140 pounds. He was in motion. And a lot of respect towards Pickett. At first, Pickett wasn't trying to hear any of it. He was, like, just mad, you know, because he was that close to winning. But Vera came through.
That's great for a guy like that. From Ecuador, and he knew about Brad Pickett. You know what I mean? You could tell the guy's a real fan. And, you know, it's a good guy right there to cheer for.
Yeah. All right,
talk to you later.
All right, take care.
You know what we didn't mention?
Our stun guns?
That, too.
Okay.
What we didn't mention was normally when a fighter because not everybody does it, but when a fighter retires, he'll leave his gloves in the middle of the ring. He left his hat.
That was cool.
That was awesome.
It was cool. That picture
wasn't that cool?
That picture was worth 1,000 words, worth 1,000,000 words. All right, let's take our last break. You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on Sirius XM Rush 93. Coming your way, another 80s hit.
Blah, blah, blah. Here are those two dummies, George and Goes.
And we're an athlete and a princess and a tough guy and a basket case. And what's the other one? A nerd? A brain?
Nerd.
He calls himself a nerd?
I thought he was a brain.
And what? I just mentioned tough guy, but what's Judd Nelson?
Thug? I thought a nerd.
A thug? No, that's Anthony Michael Hall was a nerd.
Wait, what was he?
I know she's a princess, and he's an athlete, and she's a basket case.
She's a basket case? Ally Sheedy?
Yeah.
I don't know. Damn it.
Hey, so in that movie, at some point, Judd Nelson spits in the air and catches it, right? But he overcame all that, and he got his ass kicked. Remember he got his ass kicked?
Mm-hmm.
He overcame all that and was still able to impress Molly Ringwald so that they're a couple towards the end.
Yeah.
Like, there was a lot of signs where she can go, what a fucking loser. For one, I can't go out with him. He's got the next 8 weeks detentions. He catches his own loogies. He got his ass kicked.
She gave him a diamond earring.
Right, and then...
We just met, like, a couple hours ago.
He's got the issues with the family at home. Like, I mean, she didn't think of all that?
Here's what I don't understand is they had to write the essay, right? Each one of them had to write an essay.
Mm-hmm.
But at some point, they just made the decision that one guy's going to do it.
Right, and it wasn't a thousand words either.
No, it wasn't.
Wasn't even close.
So were they risking, like, when they turned that in, couldn't he just go, this ain't what I asked for. Come back again next week.
Right. Also, what did the basket case do? She did something gross, too, at the very beginning. I forget what it was.
She did the pop rock.
Her hair.
Her hair?
Oh, yeah, when she shook it out. That's right.
Oh,
yeah.
The dandruff?
She shakes it out and because she had drawn something, and so that was snow, I guess. It was supposed to do the effect of snow.
Yeah,
so how is it that Emilio Estevez, who plays the part of whatever his name was, at the end, yeah, she comes out and looks good, but I don't remember her getting a shampoo and a thorough body cleanse or anything like that. Basically, she just did the hair, the makeup, right?
Mm-hmm.
And at the end, he comes out, same thing, long-ass make-out kiss in front of the family. And he didn't think of that? Like, I don't know, man. There was some holes there for sure.
Yeah, a lot of holes in that story.
The other guy was a rebel.
Was he? Oh, yeah, that's right, a rebel. So a rebel and a nerd? He says nerd or a brainiac?
A brain,
okay.
A brain, a beauty, a jock, a rebel. And a recluse?
No. Wait. Victoria, you were on fire there for a second. I know he's an athlete, and she's a princess.
Uh-huh.
And she's the other one's a basket case. I couldn't remember.
Who are we missing?
Well, how does he identify himself? As a rebel or a thug or a...
I think it was a rebel.
That's what it says on the cover, like a DVD cover.
For sure? You're looking at it?
It's a brain, a beauty, a jock, a rebel, and a recluse.
I don't think that's how it's said at the end, though, as they're reading the actual essay that he wrote. I think it comes out different. And I just watched it. That's why it's kind of fresh in my memory.
Mm-hmm.
I watched it, and they explained it in a certain way. But I don't think they said a jock. I think he said, and an athlete, and a princess, and a basket case, and a this and a that.
Does that movie still hold up today for like younger generations to watch?
It wouldn't happen today.
Yeah.
You don't think it would happen today?
Well, because everybody's on their phones. Nobody would talk to each other.
Oh, you mean the premise of it. Okay.
You know which one doesn't make sense anymore?
What?
Remember Back to School with Rodney Dangerfield?
Yeah.
Wouldn't that get shot down in a second? Like, what? You're dating Thornton Mellon, your student?
What do
you
mean?
Got a lot of explaining to do.
What do you mean?
Diane.
Oh.
She'd get kicked out of school. People would look at her weird.
Yeah.
He'd probably get expelled.
Did they wind up dating?
Yeah.
She stopped dating Philip?
Yeah.
Hmm. Interesting. Would that... Huh? Oh, a criminal? A criminal.
Criminal.
All right. A criminal, a brain, a princess, a basket case, and an athlete, right?
Yeah.
There you go. All right. Interesting. So that one, what's that movie called?
The Breakfast Club.
I was going to say 16 Candles there for a second, but The Breakfast Club, check it out. Yeah, there's something to it. Come on. Back in the 80s, I guess they were just putting out movies and not making sense of it all wasn't at the top of the priority list.
I guess. It was a good movie.
Yeah. Great soundtrack, too. So check it out. John Hughes, great movie maker. All right. Second hour is going to come up in about 4.5 minutes. We're going to take a commercial. Sports update. We'll open up the lines at 866-522-2846. We'll keep talking about WSOF 35, which we really haven't touched on, and then UFC Fight Night 107, plus March Madness and stun gun stories. So stay close. Turning day into night, time turning night into daytime. If you see it once,
You'll never be the same again.
King Kong has a lot of shit on them. Like a lot, especially goes. Here, Gorgeous George and goes.
All right, we're back. We might have a surprise guest goes. So let's get to some stun gun stories. Want to lead things off here? Who pissed you off this past weekend? Or did something piss you off this past weekend? You want to let out your frustrations?
A lot of things pissed me off this weekend, but one in particular. If you've been in our studio before, you know that in front of us are these windows. And anytime there's a lot of people around or a big event, we open up the windows. So I had them open. We were watching games. And a lady comes up to the window and says, I'd like to make a bet. And I told her, well, we just do a radio show here. We don't do bets. That's over there. And I pointed over to where she can place a bet. And her response was not, oh, egg on my face, or thank you, sir, my mistake. She just rolled her eyes and walked away. What the fuck did I do? I couldn't have handled that situation any better. I could have taken her bet, and she would have never seen me again. I mean, wasn't that... I thought I did everything that I could have done. She didn't seem drunk or nothing. I don't get why I was treated that way in return. So I'm going to stun gun her. Take that.
That's it? Oh, there you go. We hosted a lot of people in this studio. We got to come up with a system next year to maybe
I like the one you
shorten the list because it was just packed here and we can't have it. I was stressing out. There's too many computer there's headphones and computers and too much electronics that where a beer can, you know, tip things over and now we have ourselves a problem. And I don't like that feeling. So yeah, we're going to have to limit the amount next year for sure. But what made me the most mad was that stain right there. Because guess what? We're not oblivious to the fact that stuff can happen. I've spilled a beer before. Or a water. Or whatever. Chili sauce. I don't know. Guess what you do? You alert the host. Hey, do you have a napkin? Do you have a towel? Do you have a this, the that, Simple Green? Whatever, man. You know, and you get in there and you do something about it. You don't just... You don't go to the host... You can go to someone's house that where they're hosting, do something and not say nothing. That's what you do at a neighborhood party or a frat house party or something like that. Because you know what? That's when you're a dick in college or in high school. You're an asshole and you just go, let them deal with it or whatever. And you just tiptoe out and laugh about it maybe even if you're that much of a prick. But that's when you're younger and immature. But as an adult, you know, you go, oh, damn, this happened. And you know what? You take it on the chin like a man or a woman. You just go, my bad, and this and that or whatever. If it's even something serious, if it's a broken window, you go, how do we make good on this? Can I write you a check, or do you have insurance? Whatever. That's the extreme cases. But here was just a stain, man. It looks like a coffee stain or a thick beer, maybe.
Yeah, or a dark beer.
Why couldn't someone send that? All we would have to do was call the maintenance people, and they would have came in here, and they deal with that all the time. But just tell us. It's the fact that someone did it and didn't say shit. And now it's like a thicker stain, and I don't know. It just bugged me. It really bugged me.
It bugged me, too.
And it sucked because, this studio is really a studio. But on the weekend, it becomes one of the cooler spots to watch games. And so the fact that we share that with people, I wish there would just be a little bit more respect.
And they just ruined it for everyone else because next year, you're not a whale.
Please stun gun them. All right, what you got?
Hey guys.
Fool. I'm talking to Victoria. All right, go ahead, Victoria. No. Aaron from Texas trying to jump the queue over here.
I like that Victoria did say me. Saying I'm a fool. I like that.
So I'm stun gunning my friend Grace, who invited me to this hatchet throwing bar. I've never been before. One just opened by us.
A hatchet throwing bar? What's that?
They have them now.
You basically drink... And then you throw hatchets at this target. I guess it's kind of like darts. It's not really easy. It's pretty hard, actually. So she invites me. I said, yeah, I'll go. And then 2 days later, she went. And I told her, I'm like, oh, thanks for the invite. And she said, you didn't answer me.
But you did answer her,
You
right?
said, yeah, I'll go?
Yeah, I said I'll go.
She Via text?
Said when.
Facebook?
Via
Twitter?
Text. I have. Actually, it was on Snapchat, so... The message did erase, so.
Ooh, well then you, look, I don't want to be Grace's white knight, but isn't that the one where the message disappears? That's what you just confirmed, right?
the message did disappear, yeah.
So there's a chance you may have said yes, and she just didn't see it, and therefore it disappeared.
No, she got it. She got it.
Oh, she got it? There's a confirmation to that?
Yeah, because you could see when they read the message.
Oh, okay.
On Snapchat.
There you go, Grace. Take that.
You know what the best part of her story is? Mm. Technically, she got the axe.
Me?
A hatchet bar.
Yeah.
Those are popular now?
Well, they just opened one here in Vegas. Uh-huh. And so you go, you can drink. But then it's the one, you know, where you take like an axe or whatever.
Right.
And throw it over your head. And
that just seems dangerous mixed with alcohol. I mean, how sharp is this thing? Is it a...
It's sharp enough to hit the target and stick.
Okay.
Yeah.
But,
so
I mean, you're only
like
throwing it ahead
play version
of
it?
So, I mean, unless somebody pops up in front of you,
right.
It should be good.
Mm. Victoria, is everything cool? Did you guys bury the hatchet or...?
Yeah, everything's cool.
Oh, okay. All right.
But you'll be able to attend future events? You haven't been chopped?
No, not yet.
All right. Aaron from Texas. First of all, congratulations to you and your fiancé.
Thank you.
Victoria. Yeah. Oh, sorry. Veronica. Veronica. Victoria's our producer. Sorry.
It's okay.
Veronica. You proposed this past weekend.
I did.
Nice.
On the airplane right out here. 35,000 feet.
This is Aaron from Texas, by the way.
Yeah, the whole freaking state of Texas, don't forget it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we proposed to her. Southwest was what we took out here, and they were super cool, man. I told them a few days beforehand. They put a note on my account. Then when we checked in that day, I told them, hey, this is what I want to do, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
They let us do it, and we had three people take videos, three attendants, and then they gave all the videos to us afterwards. And then the pilot was awesome. He called ahead. They had a chilled bottle of champagne waiting for us when we landed.
That is cool.
That is awesome.
Southwest never disappoints. You know that?
Fly Southwest, guys. That's all I can say. They're super cool about the whole thing. And
the only thing I don't like is that they send me this credit card that says, how'd you like to join? And you get like 50,000 points added to the 6,000 you already have, blah, blah, blah. Which in reality, what that means is I could take those 50,000 points plus my 6 or 8 that I have, cash it in, and it's worth about $800. It's worth 2 tickets. Here's the thing I don't like about the credit card, though. They sneak it in there. The APR is competitive. But $99 annual fee, ooh, I don't like it. And this
like
is a company
either.
That doesn't charge you for the bags.
Nope.
And doesn't charge you to change flights, you know, the fee, you know.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So I've always thought, God, you know, like I love Southwest, but that $99 fee. Now, if they were to come back and go, hey, fat boy, guess what? You catch all these breaks. Let us catch one. You know what? I might actually go, all right, I feel you. I just won't do business with you. But that at least is a decent excuse. But all the other credit cards that I see out there, like 39 or non-existent or whatever, it's like, get me on the APR, you got me. Mm-hmm. Or get me if I'm ever late, all right, the late fee. But don't get me on something that just goes, hey, you're with us another year. Guess what? $100 is added to your account. I mean, I've never understood that.
Yeah, I don't like that. But
I love the way they handled your spot. So continue on.
Thank you. PR was amazing with them. So we land. We spent 2 days here. We saw the Backstreet Boys in concert.
Stung on Aaron for seeing the Backstreet Boys. What kind of a guy watches the Backstreet Boys?
That's
kind of
messed up. She didn't get to do something she wanted to do?
No, she had. I had as much fun as she did. She loved that show. And
who's your favorite? Howie? Who?
Everybody's trusted.
Dude, you know who his favorite is. It's everybody.
Backstreet's back. All right. Yeah, I had just as much fun as she did. She actually, I should stun gun her, but I'm not going to because she's actually here. But in our work group chat, she actually posted a video of me singing that song.
You met her at work?
Huh?
You met her at work?
No. In my work group work chat on my phone.
Oh. How'd you two meet?
Do you want the story of what we tell her mom or what we actually met?
What? How you actually met?
Unless
her mom's a viewer of MMA Junkie Radio.
I don't think she is. Should I? I'm going to say it. We met on Tinder.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you probably should have
put it. Who's the one that wanted to go more? What does that mean?
To the Backstreet Boys.
Was this supposed to be? Oh, the Backstreet Boys. Oh, you're like on a delay there, Veronica. We covered that about a minute ago. But so you both had to swipe right, right?
Yeah, we both swipe right.
And then when you met up, was it like, all right, you ready to go? Like, because Tinder's for another purpose.
Well, it used
or was
to be.
This for the purpose of like, hey, I'd like to meet a significant other.
That's what it would be for. I mean, Tinder used to be the hookup thing.
No, it didn't used to be. It still is.
Well, but for the most part, like almost every profile I read before I met her was 9 out of 10 of them females would say, not looking for a hookup.
Mm-hmm.
So, but with her, I mean, literally we both had the same scenario happen 3 weeks before we met. We both had came out of something bad happened and we both like, no, we're done with dating. And then we both swipe right and 7 months later we're engaged.
Mm-hmm. So. And so what do you tell her mom?
Huh? What we tell her mom is that we met through a church friend. Her mom's a real conservative Baptist, so we, you know, she doesn't understand Tinder, online
just
dating.
Tell you, if she overhears something, just say it was called Tender, not Tinder.
Tender.
Maybe that'll throw her off. Tender? I don't see the app. Just say they collapsed. They couldn't raise any more money, and it's gone.
I don't think her mom has a smartphone, so we don't have to worry about that app.
All right, so what's the stun gun story?
Okay, all right. So we did that Saturday, Backstreet Boys Saturday. Sunday, we were going to go take a helicopter tour through Maverick. Now, I have nothing bad to say about the Maverick company. They're amazing. Every time I call them, they're amazing. But the freaking driver who met us at the Bellagio at 9 o'clock, he did the proverbial. He gave, like, we were like, we called, hey, is this the driver? Yes, the driver. He pulls up, he parks. We go up to the same high. He goes, no, go over there. So we walked over there. And then he gets out. He gives us the proverbial Heisman, just boom, hand to face, not wanting to see us. And he was very rude. Said, oh, somebody else will get you. He just parked there, got on his phone, and...
How do you know he was your driver, then?
Because they said he was arriving at that point.
Oh, I see.
And then and the funny thing was, he actually had another couple with him, and they let them off to go get somebody else. And by that time, pickup's an hour beforehand. It was like 9:15, and I'm like, we're not going to make it on time, you know? And her mood was killed, my mood was killed, and I was just like, yeah, it's not.
That's the helicopter ride that goes to the Grand Canyon or the one that goes around town?
They do both. They do a Grand Canyon.
Which one were you going to do?
We're going to do the Strip.
Okay.
So it's just like, and I had, like I said, nothing issue about the company besides that guy, but it's just as rude as he was, and everybody here in town, for the 90% of the time, is so nice, but it's just, at that point, we didn't want to give him our money because it's just, you know, we felt like, you know, they took a romantic part of our weekend away by just being a complete asshole. So, stun gun that son of a bitch.
You got it, dude.
So. And I should stun
Shouldn't you be used to being disappointed by the Mavericks? I've seen your basketball team out there in Dallas. They're not that good.
Didn't the Lakers blow a 9-point lead last night to the Cavs? Weren't they resting most of their starters?
We are young and we're rebuilding, so take that.
You've been saying that for 5 years.
Well, maybe, I guess. It takes a while.
Yeah, I know.
So are you going to delete all your other profiles, like
FarmersTanOnly.com? FarmersTanOnly. No, that one's going to stay on there. I deleted them all.
This is the same Aaron who, by the way, calls into the show. And who we've given praise for judging and reffing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good job on that.
Thank you, man. Appreciate it, man. We got a big UFC coming in May, so, you know.
Wouldn't that be cool? You think you can get on that?
I can't say too much. If I did, great. If I don't, that's fine too, man. You know, it's just I'll be at the show watching anyway because it's going to be an amazing fight card. And if I get to be a bigger part of it, whatever reason, whether as a judge, referee, inspector, timekeeper, ticket taker, I'm in. You know, man, I don't care. I love doing judging, refereeing. And the thing is, and I hope more junkies hear this, we need people who actually care about this sport. We need people who actually love this sport, who are not there to collect a paycheck, who are not there just to be seen or be cool or be part. Oh, look, here's where I am. It's a social status. No, we need people who care because it peeves me to see people, you know, in any commission, but to see people who are not there for the right reasons, you know, and you know, I know I talked to a couple other junkies before about doing it, and I think one of them from Utah, Josh, I don't remember his last name, but I know he's one of our junkies from Utah. He's an inspector for the Utah Commission. Mm-hmm. So that's really cool. And I'm trying to get Billy, who's sitting outside over
Chili
here.
Chili Billy?
We need to get Chili Billy on commission as well. So, and eventually, we had lunch with Carla and a homie yesterday, and so did Billy. And Carla was kind of giving her some hints about, hey, it's not too bad to live out here in Las Vegas. So you never know. Mm-hmm. You never know.
Okay.
It could be cool. So.
We got a surprise guest. But again, congratulations.
Oh, thank you.
For the, you know, the prenuptials. Eventually, you're going to get to that. What is that?
Well, because I think I may be getting sick. I'm not sure.
Oh, I see.
Oh, appreciate it, man.
Okay.
Yeah.
No problem. It was nice to meet your fiance.
And we'll be back out here in
Keep
May.
Keep hanging out. Okay, cool. Oh, you out here or are you hanging out?
Yeah, we'll hang out here. Right. We'll be back out here in May for that gathering. We both will.
All right, cool. All right, folks. I think we have a surprise guest. Is he ready to go, Victoria?
Yeah, he's ready.
Guess what, goes? His name's Lorenz Larkin.
Oh, yeah.
Newest member of Bellator MMA.
I like that guy.
Well, so, Lorenz, how you doing?
What up?
Welcome back to MMA Junkie Radio. You're on with George and Goes. Wow, this was a process, wasn't it? It's like being pregnant. Did we go the whole 9 months before finally a decision was made here recently?
I know, man. It didn't go. I mean, I thought it was going to be a little sooner, but geez.
I remember we discussed this when we were at JBLE in Virginia. You know, there was a chance it could be done there within a few weeks, and here we are, third week into March. It finally happened, I guess. What was the holdup?
You know what, man? Oh, shit. What up, Junkie Nation? I almost forgot, man. Now you let me just fly without doing that. Anyway, nah, man. You know, I don't know. It was kind of quiet, you know, for a while. I'm not even going to lie, you know. There's kind of no feedback. And then it starts getting some traction, you know, and I start, you know, talking with, like, ACB, Ryzen, Arisen, and then Bellator, you know, and it was just kind of going back and forth. Nothing serious, you know. I think it was more, you know, a lot of people wanted to see how serious I was in this whole free agency thing, you know, or if I was really willing to leave, you know. So, right. I mean, everything pretty much went full speed within the past 3 weeks.
Okay. Now, ACB and Ryzen would have been the type of promotions, and not that Bellator isn't going international or anything, but these are the type of promotions where most of your fighting would have been done overseas. Was that, like, appealing to you, or was that, you know, one of the, I guess, turnoffs of promotions, overseas promotions?
You know what? It was kind of – that was a big factor, you know, as far as I wasn't too familiar with testing and stuff like that out in different countries and now for, you know, I guess more foreign promotions.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, I got the chance to go to ACB in Manchester, mm-hmm. and I had a teammate fight for them, and you know, that show's nice, and that show is ran clean, you know, and it would have been a good show to fight for, too, you know, after I got to experience everything, you know, those guys really have a tight promotion, and they take care of their guys.
What were the top three things you were looking for?
What was that?
What were the top three things you were looking for in terms of, you know, where you were going to ultimately decide where you wanted to sign? Like, I'm sure the dollars and cents had to make sense, but what else were you looking for in terms of what a promotion had to offer?
You know, I just wanted to feel like I was an asset to a promotion. You know, I feel like, you know, that I can... I just wanted to be somewhere where, you know, a promotion really thought that I could help out the company and just be an asset and have somebody that really is really excited to work with me, you know? And that was a really big thing for me, you know, and that's the whole reason why I tested free agency out, you know? I mean, don't get me wrong, you know, like I said, you know, every fighter wants a better financial situation. But, you know, I'm not willing to take a financial situation with somebody that just doesn't, you know, give a shit about me. You know, I want somebody that wants to work with me, and then we can come to a mutual deal, you know, that makes sense for both of us and have that backing behind me, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Lorenz Larkin joins us here on MMA Junkie Radio. We're discussing his decision to sign with Bellator MMA. All right, Goes, what do you have for Lorenz?
Lorenz, the initial negotiation, I know a lot of people think that has to do with dollars and cents and all that, but some people say it has to do with predicting the future a little bit. So your place as soon as you come into Bellator, is there anything in there that says, like, you have to fight a specific name first or you get a title shot, an immediate title shot, anything like that? Do you know where your place is the minute you come into Bellator?
No, there's nothing that was, you know, written out like you have to fight this person or this. I think it was – I'm trying to think of what – the deal came out, you know, pretty organically, you know. I know my team has been talking with Bellator often, I mean, you know, a little bit. But, you know, this deal kind of took, you know, to the final – everything finally, you know, because my team was just talking back and forth, but I was able to get on the phone with Scott, you know, when I was at the airport, and we really knocked out everything within 40 minutes, if that.
Wow. Coming in to Bellator,
you know what I mean?
Right away, like how far do you feel you are away from a title shot?
I don't, I, tell you the truth, I honestly don't even know. You know, I think I'm more just focused on fighting. You know, I just want to fight because it's been a while. You know, I haven't been injured. You know, so it's like, I guess I got the itch.
What about Bellator? It gives you the opportunity to showcase your personality. And you're actually a really funny guy. Have you thought about what your entrance would look like, that big video screen behind you? I know a lot of fighters have been able to give input on what they would like it to look like. Have you thought about that at all?
I don't know too much, man. I know for sure, you know, I got to have some of the, you know, Riverside Bells in there, you know. And I'm not too sure. But I know for sure that has to be in there. That's like a deal breaker. It got to have a Riverside Bell.
Do you already know how soon you might pop up on a card?
No, you know, I'm not too sure. I was hoping that maybe I get a little bit of insight on, because I'm going out to Chicago for the Rampage card, you know. So hopefully, I get a little insight when I'm out there, maybe, you know, about what type of time frame, you know. I heard talks of, I think Fedor fighting again, mm-hmm. you know, like a rescheduled fight. Somewhere in like New York. I don't know how much of it is true or not, but that would be cool.
Well, this division's one of the ones where they're really, really stacking things up nicely. You know, they have Brendan Ward, Douglas Lima, Andre Korshkov, Michael Page, Paul Daly, Chidi Njokuani, Rory McDonald, yourself, the Menifee, a maniac, Fernando Gonzalez. I hope I have his name right. Yeah, Fernando Gonzalez. So any of those names jump out at you like, oh, yeah, I want to mix it up with that cat?
You know what? Any of them, man. I'm cool with Chitty, so I ain't going to put Chitty in there. But, you know, anybody else, was, you know, it's all fair game, you know? Mm-hmm.
I love it. I love it, man. You said Ryzen, ACB, and Bellator, they, I guess it was a three-horse race till the end?
No, it wasn't necessarily a three-horse race, but, you know, in the end, you know, we were kind of talking with ACB and Bellator. That was at the end.
Okay. Did you get anything out of the overseas promotion, 1FC? Did they even come at you?
No.
Okay. Did you even want to go, I guess? They fight primarily in Asia. Would that have been something that was appealing to you in any way?
Yeah, I tell you the truth, I wouldn't even know, man. I guess we would have to go on how the conversations went, you know?
Right. World Series of Fighting, did they come at you at all?
Nope.
Okay. And then the UFC, how far were they in the game?
You know, they would, it's probably like 2 weeks ago that I had an offer from them. Mm-hmm. I think it was about 2 weeks ago, maybe two and a half weeks ago, mm-hmm. they submitted their offer.
Okay. In the end, what was it that you didn't want to go back to them?
It just didn't feel right, you know?
Gotcha.
Took it as a, you know, take it or leave it type of thing, and it just didn't feel right, you know?
Right. Okay. Well, it'd be great to see you fight sooner rather than later, because I think your last fight was in August. So, yeah, you must be chomping at the bit. You've usually been a pretty busy fighter throughout your career.
Yeah, you know, I don't pull out. I make weight, and I'm always there when it's fight time. You know what I mean? So, I'm pretty smart when it comes to training. Let me knock on some wood. I'm about to jump in the gym right now. Watch me hurt myself. But, no. You know, I just don't pull out, man. I'm always there to fight.
Also, how tell me a little bit about the sponsorship now. It's going to change. It's going to come back. Is this exciting times, I guess, for fighters and the sponsorship? Like, you know, did you have like a lot of support before, and now you can, you know, dust off that contact book and say, hey, listen, I'm going to be back in front of 110 million homes, and you can back me, and you know, you can fill up your trunks and your walkout attire now again.
Yeah, you know, I'm anxious to see how it all plays out. You know, I wasn't feeling too bad about, you know, when I was in UFC with the whole sponsorship deal, because, you know, I was, say if I would have fought again, that would have been my 16th fight, you know, under Zuffa, mm-hmm. You know, so, you know, I wasn't doing too bad on the whole Reebok thing, mm-hmm. But you know, I'm pumped. I'm really excited to see how everything goes. You know, I'm pumped to be working with sponsors again, and I'm happy about it.
It's funny that it comes down to a 40-minute conversation with Scott Coker, because I think that's how he explained him and Fedor just came to it. You know, so even though the negotiations take a long time, I think pinning down Scott Coker is the key for anybody that's listening going forward. You want to fight for Bellator, just ring up Scott Coker.
No, you know, he's just a straight-up shooter, man, and it was just organic, the whole deal, man. It was literally just me at the airport and just talking with him.
What was the final thing he said to you that just convinced you that was the right move?
He just expressed to me that, you know, that he's always been excited for me no matter what move I made, and it was just organic, man. You know, he was just a lot of things. He was just like, you know, I'm just a fan of you. You know, I was happy to see you go to, you know, UFC and do what you did, and, you know, every time you fight, I watch you fight. You know, and if he just made it seem like, you know, even if we can't make a deal, I'm still happy to see you, you know, do whatever you do. Mm-hmm. You know, and it was just warming, you know, to hear that and talk to him and just to come out with a deal like that. Mm-hmm. You know, just that fast, you know.
How many fights?
I got 6 fights.
6 fights. Very cool. All right. Hey, man, we're happy for you. We're happy that this finally came to a conclusion. And I'm sure it was probably stressful at times, but maybe there was some times where it was also exciting, you know, just being loved by other promotions and being courted by other promotions, and then eventually being able to decide your future. Having those options must have been a fun thing at some point, too.
Yeah, you know, this whole experience has been fun, man, and I'm really content with, you know, me going through this whole experience and seeing the outcome of it. Mm-hmm.
By the way, you got something for that middleweight champion too. I know you've done it before, and I could see you competing at welterweight or middleweight, or is this just a focus on welterweight for now?
The focus is on welterweight, you know. But I mean, I'm all game, man. My thing is, like I always said, you know, I'm willing to work, you know, and if I can help out the company by doing something that makes sense, you know, then I'm all for it, you know.
Very cool. Thanks for sharing some time with us, Lorenz. Congrats on everything.
All right. Thanks, guys.
All right. Take care. We'll see you. All right, folks. That's Lorenz Larkin, newest member of Bellator MMA. He's got some sexy matchups there awaiting him at the welterweight division, but I really feel like goes – I've seen Carvalho fight. No disrespect to him. He's solid, but I think Lorenz also, if he wants to mix it up at that division, he could become a contender there too.
This is exactly the type of fighter that I've been talking about that Bellator needs. A guy that you can create fresh matchups with. He's a solid guy. He's young. He's fast. He's good everywhere. So it's kudos to them. It's a great pickup.
We're going to take a commercial. When we come back, we're going to talk to King Mo Lawal. He's got a fight coming up at the Bellator card on the 31st in Hoffman Estates, just outside of Chicago, Illinois. He'll be opposing his longtime nemesis, Rampage Jackson. We'll also talk to him about March Madness. The Penn State Nittany Lions goes just won another championship in 6 out of 7 years. That's quite a dynasty there, man. We'll be right back after this break.
Will be a lot better. Here are gorgeous Senkos.
And there you have it, folks, an early preview of King Mo's walkout music for his fight that's coming up in about a week or so against Quentin Rampage Jackson.
Only joining, we get these exclusives.
Joining us now is King Mo. What's up, King Mo? How you doing?
Man, y'all trying to play me on the radio.
What would it take for you to walk out to that?
You know, if I had a briefcase and I opened it up and I go, hey, I just talked to the DJ, you're walking out to this, and in that briefcase it was 50 grand, would you do it?
Nah, I couldn't.
For 50 grand, you wouldn't do it?
I mean, music is important to me. That's one thing. I love music, man. It's important to me. You know, it can change my mood or my demeanor, like, just like that. And 50 grand, I love money, but, man, like, I like my interest music the best.
Yeah, but you're wearing headphones when you're coming
grand,
out.
Nah, I can't do that. If you get 100 grand, man, I come out to a Boo Scooby Boogie. I don't care.
So we're close. We're close.
So we just didn't hit us.
We just needed to double it. Yeah.
All right,
Mo, we'll talk about Rampage in a sec, but March Madness, you know, we were trying, man. They had it on a couple TVs here at the Mandalay Bay. But basically, everybody wanted to see the colleges, the basketball. Do you think they'll ever switch weekends and just kind of get out of that, you know, that shell, I guess, and have their own weekend? Because I think a lot of more people would tune in.
Man, I'm gonna be real with you, man. I don't know. I wish, like, you know, talking about the college wrestling.
Right.
I wish they pick a time before. You know what I'm saying? Maybe or after.
Right.
That'd be smart, but. I guess it's just tradition. They do it that week.
Mm-hmm. Well, all right. It went down. Penn State did it again. God, I mean, it's wrestling. I mean, Division I wrestling is very, very competitive. And these guys won, like, if I'm not mistaken, 5 national champions. And they swept from, like, 49 to 84, if I'm not mistaken. That's pretty damn impressive haul for Penn State.
Yeah, it is impressive, but that college wrestling is competitive. But the thing is, the issue with college wrestling is you have the same 5-6 schools that are always in the top 6. You know what I'm saying? It's like that traditionally because they have the power to recruit. And Penn State right now is, man, like, Cale Sanderson doing a good job out there. Cunningham's out there. As a coach, they got guys that are staying after, you know, and you know, Taylor's out there. You know, they got good staff, you know, and they're wrecking shop right now.
Mm-hmm. Oklahoma State did have one champion at 141 pounds. And as far as runner-ups, they didn't have any other. What do you see for the Cowboys going forward? You know, how can they close the gap on Penn State?
It's going to come down to recruiting. It's going to come down to staff. And it's going to come down to, you know, when – the guys that graduate, they need to stay behind and wrestle with the young kids coming up. Because Penn State has I guarantee if you went to Penn State, they have a room full of wrestlers, past and present. They're wrestling all together. And it's going to take guys like, you know, Derek Dieringer, you know what I'm saying? He's there at 165. And he's one of the top guys in the United States right now. He's there. They're going to come, it's going to come down to recruiting, it's going to come down to the staff. That's what's going to come down to.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, second place, by the way, went to Ohio State. Third place was Oklahoma State. Fourth place, Iowa. And fifth place, Missouri. But, yeah, Penn State had 5 national champions, and they swept, like I said, from 49 to 184 pounds. I couldn't believe it. It was one right after the other. And a couple other guys took out defending champions, too. Excuse me?
Yeah, Bo Nickel. Shout out to Bo Nickel. Bo Nickel from Texas. He's a Texas boy. He beat Gabe Dean from Cornell. returning national champion, two-time national champion. Bo Nickel beat him. You know, saying shout out to him. He's a great wrestler. He's gonna be one of those guys you're gonna read about making the Olympic team. Mm-hmm. He's a exciting wrestler to watch. He goes for broke, big moves. Can take you down. Can out scramble you. Strong, very athletic. He's gonna be the man. But it's time to shine on the Olympic scene.
Can any of these guys like Kyle Snyder, Jaden Cox, Bo Nickel, Mark Hall, Vincenzo Joseph, Jason Nolfo, all these champions, or even the runners-up, do any of them have a future in MMA? Could you tell just from athleticism or toughness that some of these cats, we might be seeing them on your type of stage soon?
I think you can. It's just, they have potential from what they've accomplished, but it's just hard to say because you never know. Look at Thompson Sanders. He was Thompson Sanders did everything. And when he went to the UFC, he really didn't do much. You know what I'm saying? Like, he wasn't built for the weight class. You know, some guys are fighters, some guys ain't. You know, some guys will go out there and slug it out and figure out ways to win in the cage. Some guys, right when a punch get thrown at their face, they cover up and get that leg up and turn their head. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So you just never know until you actually bring them into a MMA environment and see how they interact with the rest.
Mm-hmm. You have Quentin Jackson ahead of you on March 31st. I know how you feel about this, that you won the first fight, and that Quentin believes it as well, because you said he asked you for a rematch even before they announced the scores. What are you setting out to prove in this fight with Quentin Jackson?
Nothing, put it like this. I'm going to show I'll be the better me. I'm going to show that I'm proof from the last fight. I'm going to show the gap is widened. Because, man, if I don't know, my boy hit me up and was like, Mo, man, you got to hear what Quentin's saying. And I'm like, what's he saying? And he's like, he's saying that going for takedown is a sign of weakness. And he's saying that, he wanted to fight guys like Krokop and Fedor or not me. And, you know, and all this, man, it's like this. I don't get where he's coming from, man. To me, either he's LD or he's just delusional. You know, When it's time for a step in the cage, I'm going to show that I'm going to hold a different level than him. And it's like this. I don't care the weight class. I'm not going to use a weight class as an excuse. You know what I'm saying? I wanted this fight, so I took it at heavyweight. You know what I'm saying? I know he can't make 205. I could easily decline, but I want this fight that bad. You know what I'm saying? They offered me a fight at heavyweight. They know it was, but I took it. And when it's Quentin, man, maybe you want to train that much harder. Mm-hmm. And I'm ready. I'm ready to go now. You know what I'm saying?
King Mo, our guest here on MMA Junkie Radio. He's fighting at Bellator at 175, Rampage versus King Mo 2, the Allstate Arena in Rosemont, Illinois. I think I said Hoffman Estates, Illinois, but they have a couple different arenas out there. This one's at the Allstate Arena, and again, it's on the 31st of March. And Spike TV's got you covered with a 9 p.m. Eastern start time. That is your main event. You'll also see Emmanuel Sanchez versus Marcos Galvao, Sergey Karatan off a guest of ours on Wednesday's show. He'll be facing off against Chase Gormley. Goes, what do you have for King Mo?
Mo, is a good, hard-fought decision good enough for you in this situation, or is this a scenario where you really want to hurt this guy and end the fight?
Well, I always want to hurt my opponents to end the fight. But the thing is, my thing is, I want to show the gap as wide. If I can get a stoppage, that's cool. If I can get a few 10 rounds, that's cool. If I just torture him and just, if he's out there doing a bunch of nothing, just getting manhandled, that's cool with me. My thing is, I want to make it hell for him for 1 second to 15 minutes, whatever it is. I want to make it hell for him and make him pay for 1 second or for 15 minutes. That's what my goal is. That's what my plan is right there.
I know you felt you won the first fight. So going forward, if you win this fight, would you entertain a third fight, or do you feel like you would be up to nothing?
Man, it don't matter to me, you know what I'm saying? It's up to what Bellator want to do. If he wants to fight a third time, I'm cool with it because a fight's a fight, you know what I'm saying? But I'd be up 2-0 on him, you know, but if he wants to fight again, I'm cool with that.
Where do you think a win here puts you in your race to get back to the title?
Man, I have no idea. I really don't know. I just, whatever they, because when it comes down to it, Bellator has a plan, and the thing is, if you just keep on winning, you're going to get a title shot. You just got to keep on winning, and That's what I got to do, just keep on winning. And whoever they put in front of me, just take care of that, and the title shot will come.
Here's who I'd like to see. So Mo's got Rampage ahead of him. I'd like to see him fight, in no particular order, by the way. Phil Davis, Rafael Carvalho. Yes, that means his debut at middleweight. Rashad did it. I know Mo can do it. And then also in the heavyweight division, they got to crown a heavyweight there. And if they're not going to, you know, figure out the Minnikov situation, I don't know if you would ever fight Lashley. I think you're friends with him or whatever. But, Mitrione, I guess, is another name. Fedor, who knows? But, someone from the heavyweight division, someone from the light heavyweight division, someone from the middleweight division. That'd be a legendary run there for you.
And then actually, that would be a good run. I can't lie. I do like it. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'll tell you this. Before it's all said and done, I will fight at 185 before I'm done fighting. I tell you that. Because during this camp, there are a few times I hit 204. You know what I'm saying? Just during. And right now, I'm eating whatever I want. You know, I'm training. You know, it's a heavyweight. So, my goal is I want to at least weigh 215. If I weigh less, oh well. But my goal is at least come in and weigh 215.
Mm-hmm. If you did do a run like that, which would you do first, the heavyweight, the light heavyweight, or the middleweight?
I would do heavyweight first, because heavyweight then go back down. Because thinking with heavyweight, it'd be my natural weight anyway. You know, 210, 212, and then I could cut down later.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I thought maybe as someone gets older and cutting weight becomes more difficult, so I thought maybe the middleweight fight would be the one that you might want to do, since Davis could very likely be looking at Ryan Bader. Ryan Bader might be headed your guys' way. I thought maybe middleweight, which needs a little bit of an infusion of talent, maybe could use your services early, and then, you win the title, let it go, and then move up and maybe figure out the winner of Bader and Davis, and then finish off with some heavyweight fights. And then at that point in time, you just want to sweat losing weight or weight cuts anymore to end your career.
Well, yeah, because with me, I don't really gain weight like that. You know, I have a few times I was bloated, but then I lose the weight quick. But for the most part, like for me, my body, I'm probably going to, when I'm done fighting, I'm going to lose weight, most likely.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Because after fights, I don't train, I'm not hungry. I just sip soda and Mountain Dew and Pepsi and just chill and watch TV. That's all I'd be doing.
Would you fight Bobby Lashley, by the way?
Yeah, I'd fight Bobby. Now, Bobby's cool with my boy, but, man, I'm cool with Bobby, but you know, paycheck is more important.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? I'm more cool with paycheck and Benjamin Franklin than I am with Bobby Lashley.
And did you hear Ryan Bader's probably headed your guys' way, the Bellator? What do you talk about that signing, the little infusion there in the 205 division?
Yeah, I think it's a great signing. You know, I heard it come like months ago, but I've never heard nothing of it since. But you know, I think it's a good signing. You know, I fight Bader, I fight whoever, man. It don't make no difference to me.
Cool. Well, listen, man. Good luck with the rest of your camp. You only have a few more days of some hard sessions, and it's time to travel, do the media, and then get down versus Quinton Jackson on the 31st. So, good luck with all that. Safe travels, and I'm sure we'll be talking to you again soon.
Well, I appreciate it, man.
All right, King Mo. Take care.
Yeah, take it easy.
See ya. Right. On Twitter, it's at King Mo FH. We're going to take this last break. When we come back, we'll close up shop. You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on Sirius XM Rush 93.
So now from the Hershey store, you guys welcome.
Thank you. Did you refrigerate them?
Charm, compassion,
no, did you do that
common
last night?
Sense. These guys have none of that. You listen to them, so you're no better. I am awesome, though. They are gorgeous George and Goes.
All right, I want to thank King Mo and Lorenz Larkin for doing today's show. King Mo fights Quinton Rampage Jackson on March 31st. It's a rematch of their fight from like 2-3 years ago. Controversial fight that they had because a lot of people had King Mo winning, but the ones that mattered, the judges had Rampage winning it all. So they get to do it, hurt each other. I think Rampage is a little bit more of a decline right now, you know? Mm-hmm. He just hasn't fought much, and I'm not sure that he's just in the fighting like he once was. Whereas King Mo, you can tell, still is chasing big paydays, but big fights and possible titles. So, advantage King Mo. As I say that, I realize I'm also King Mo fan. So, I'm sure I didn't shock anybody with that comment. Eric Del Fiero will join us tomorrow. We'll talk about Alliance MMA. They have a card that's coming up. Plus, he's also the head coach for Dominic Cruz. So, we'll see where he thinks his athlete might be at after that tough loss to Cody Garbrandt late last year. On Wednesday's show, we'll have Boss Rudin and Sergey Karatanov. So the names will start pouring in. Should be some fun times. Also, Lorenz Larkin made his decision finally. He took Bellator MMA's offer over ACB, the Russian outlet that's been making a lot of noise. And also Ryzen, which we've been tracking them for a couple years as well. So congratulations to Lorenz. And Victoria, we'll see her the following Monday. So great job, Victoria. Always great to catch up with you. How about you, Goz? Any parting shots, or you just can't wait to hit the hay and rest up some more from the madness that is March Madness?
Yeah, I'm going to sleep all day today, and then I got to get back on it tomorrow because I got a lot of things I got to do. But you know what I can't get out of my head? Marco's call when he brought up like the best music videos. I kind of want to see what everybody's top 10 music videos are.
What's your favorite music video? I shared mine. I don't know if it's my favorite, but I really liked Aha.
Yeah, I mean, that's up. It's got to be in the top 10. Aha. Mm-hmm. Money for
Take
Nothing.
Take on Me is the name
there.
Of the song, by the way. How about you guys? What?
Remember, he talked about Michael Jackson. He had a lot of good ones. Remember the Time was kind of fun, right? Mm-hmm. Black or White was different.
Mm-hmm. How about you, Victoria? Do you have a favorite video?
Yeah, probably all the Backstreet Boy ones.
Yeah, Fist Bump to Aaron.
Yeah. Was there a particular song?
Everybody, the one that goes sing.
Everybody.
Dude, go back, listen to the archive, and listen to your giggle when we did that.
Uh-huh. I'll write it down. I'll check it out after the show. We'll see you all tomorrow at 1 p.m. Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific, with another edition of MMA Junkie Radio. For Victoria and Goes, I'm George. Have a nice day. Go out there and be champions.
The nighttime, turning night into daytime. If you see it once, you'll never be the same.